Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you. Tonight, we can come into your presence with joy, God, appreciating all you've done for us, God. We can celebrate your love like we did tonight. Lift up a praise and a shout that you're worthy of, God. Tonight, we didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. Truly, tonight, we came to hear from you. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. We welcome it, Lord. We want to do greater things with you, Lord. We want to go farther and want to go deeper in you, God. And so we thank you that tonight that you open the eyes of our understanding. God, that you open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our lives. Lord, we know you'll do your part. God, we want to do our part, Lord. We'll give our interest, our attention. We'll listen up. God, we will prepare and be ready to apply the word to our lives as you minister that word to us. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and we bless them. God, at no time do we think of ourselves any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we ask that you bless all of our brothers and sisters. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, for the Well and for the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist. God, for all the great churches that are out there. God, we thank you, Lord, for Crossroads and for the Assemblies. God, for the Four Square denominations. God, for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. If they're preaching your gospel, your truth, God, we bless them as you would bless us this night. Also, God, we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad. We pray that you encourage them, strengthen them, bless them, God. Surround them. May they endure to the end, God. We thank you for them. Deliver them, Lord, out of the hand of their enemy, God, out of every bondage, every chain, Father God. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say,
amen.
Amen. Like I mentioned, get your Bibles, go with me to Matthew chapter number 18. We're going to be starting there, launching out from there. Before we get into the word tonight, I wanted to just give a little story that I think is going to kind of apply to the message tonight. And, you know, I heard this story. I thought it was kind of cute, kind of fun. I was a little kid in class, and it was share day at his class. And so there at school, he's getting ready. And so some of the kids shared toys. Some of the kids shared pictures from their family vacation. It was finally his time to share. And he was so excited about something he heard at church, he decided that he was going to talk to all of his classmates at school about what he had learned at church. And so it's finally his time. He gets called on. He stands up in front of the class, and the teacher says, go ahead, share what you want to share. And so he starts to share, and he says, I heard about a story in Sunday school. And there was the children of Israel, they were slaves. And God led them out of Egypt in slavery, and he brought them up to the Red Sea. And Pharaoh and all of his army were chasing after him, and they didn't know what they were going to do. They were between a rock and a hard place. And so Moses had the word of God to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And he told them to lift up his staff. So he lifted it up. And there God parted the Red Sea before them, and they walked across on dry land. And when they got to the other side, they turned around, and Pharaoh and his army were chasing them. And they thought, oh no, what are we going to do? And the Lord said, put your arm down from the staff, and the water closed in, and God wiped out Pharaoh's army right there in the Red Sea. Drowned them all in the waters. And he went back and he sat down, and the teacher was kind of sitting there. Now, the teacher was a very staunch atheist and didn't believe in God and didn't like the fact that this kid was sharing a story out of the Bible. And so he decided he was going to teach this kid a lesson. So he stood up in front of the class. He said, now, son, let me tell you something. None of that's true. That God would part the waters of the Red Sea. You know, it's a scientifically proven fact that there are parts of the Red Sea that the wind blows across and it pushes the waters, and the waters would only be about 3 feet deep in the section that the children of Israel would have crossed over. So it wasn't a supernatural phenomenon. It was just a natural thing that could have taken place. And the historical accounts are all wrong. They're attributing it to God. It was really probably just wind. And the kid says, wow, that's amazing. Isn't God cool? Hey, everybody, did you hear that? Now, the teacher's wondering, what's going on with this kid? He must have lost his mind. What's happening? He says, well, what are you saying? Why are you so excited about that? He says, because God drowned Pharaoh's army in 3 feet of water. That's awesome. Oh, that we would have faith like a child. Isn't that right? Tonight I want to talk to you about living a greater life. And let me just clear up the confusion for everyone. God parted the Red Seas. Okay, it was not 3 feet of water that they passed through. There were walls of water that went up. Living a greater life. See, Jesus came to the earth and redefined greatness for us. In our world, we look around and we've got these celebrities, we've got these superstars. And as we see people, we see these wonderful, and I don't want to diminish in the natural what they're doing. There are people who are amazing. You know, the Olympians and the athletes and the different people who have built empires of wealth and finance, people who have done great things in technology and education, people who have moved things forward. They would be the great ones, as this world would call them. And rightfully so in the world. But when Jesus came and lived among us, he gave to us a greater picture, gave to us a picture of a greater life. And now he is our example. He's the one that we are to imitate and follow after. See, it used to be that we would put the posters up on the wall and we wanted to be that star quarterback. It used to be we'd put the pictures up on the wall and we wanted to be that singing superstar. But now Jesus comes, and as we look at Jesus, we realize, oh my goodness, there's nobody like Jesus. Nobody loves me like Jesus loved me. Nobody did the works that Jesus did. Nobody came to the earth, disrobed themselves of glory, and gave it all just for my life. Now that should just bring us to a point of worship, a point of admiration, but also it should bring us to a point where we not only look at him and put him on that pedestal that he so deserves, but also to live a life. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And so Jesus is calling us to imitate him. He wants us to live a life of fulfillment, a life of blessing, a life that is successful. Did you know God wants you successful? You know that God wants you to succeed at life? God doesn't want you broke down, busted, and disgusted. God isn't just holding you down and afflicting you so that you'll learn some lesson. You know, that's not God's thing. God will use life to teach us lessons. God will work all things together for our good. But God is calling us to be imitators of Christ, to look like his son Jesus. We were just having a discussion just the other day about the term Christian. And I was talking with Pastor Luke about this term and how the original meaning of Christian, literally if you translate it, means little Christ. Think about that for a second. Bunch of little Christ running around on the earth just wreaking havoc on the devil's domain. That's what I'm talking about right there. See, I'm a little Christ. Now, I don't have a God complex. I'm not saying that I am God, but no, I've been born again into the likeness, and now I am a child of God. I am a king's kid. I'm no longer that old sinner. I'm no longer that dirt bag. I'm not any longer bound by the perversions of this world. I'm no longer bound into the addictions and afflictions of this world. The devil has no hold on me any longer. Now I am a brand new creation in Christ, and I am then called to a greater life. See, God has an extraordinary life that he wants to live in and through you. And tonight I want to talk about this type of life. Matthew chapter 18, starting in verse number 2. We were here on Sunday night, and I just want to bring this verse out because it was so powerful what we're talking about. Matthew chapter 18, starting in verse 2, then Jesus called a little child to him, set him in the midst of them. Now stop for a second, think about this right now, okay? You have a bunch of adult men, probably, at least 13 of them, Jesus and the 12 disciples. Now, they traveled with a company of people, and there were people that were always thronging Jesus. They were all around Jesus, so there are a lot of people around, okay? And Jesus calls a little child and says, hey, come up here. Sit down, right here, son. And he sits him down, okay? Think about the attitude of that child. All that child knew was that there was an adult telling them to do something and seating them in the midst of everybody else. Now, they may have been scared. They may have been wondering what's going on with everyone around me. They may have been wondering, you know, why is he calling me? Is he going to, you know, correct me for something I was doing wrong? You know, or what's going on? And yet, even in the midst of all that, that could have been going on internally, the child just immediately responds, obeys, and does exactly what the Lord says. Verse number 3. So after he does this, he says, assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Verse number 4, therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Now, Sunday night we talked about humility and how we should humble ourselves. We don't want God to humble us because that's a humbling thing. Hello. It's like asking God for patience. You pray for patience, you're going to have all sorts of situations in your life that will cause you to have to grow in patience, right? There will be delays. There will be things that take place. You're going to have to wait. God, why are you doing this to me? God says, well, you prayed for patience, so I'm just giving you opportunity to grow in it. Same thing with humility. We can either humble ourselves or we can be humbled. Why? Because God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So if I won't humble myself, I will be humbled because God will be in opposition to my life. Same thing. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things. You cannot even get saved unless you humble yourself and become as a little child. Now, that doesn't mean childish. That means childlike, right? It doesn't mean that we're naive in our thinking. That doesn't mean that we throw out our brains. It doesn't mean that as Christians we are now no longer, no knowledge, no nothing. It just, there's nothing else going on. No, this is God's world. Science is God. Math is God. All that stuff is God. God made it all. Okay, so we don't check our brains at the door. But at the same time, we are readily submitted to the word of the Lord. We humble ourselves. We depend on God. We hear his voice. We follow him. We carry out what he wants, even in the midst of something that may be going on internally. Are you listening? Lest you be converted and become as a little child, you'll by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Okay? So if we are humble, we enter the kingdom. Then now something takes place on the inside of us. Now we can live the God kind of life. Jesus was having a conversation. As he's having a conversation, some men come up and they say, hey, John the Baptist sent us to you. John's in jail. John is discouraged. And they say, John sent us to you to find out, are you really the Christ or should we wait and look for someone else? Jesus says, go tell John what you've already seen, what you already know. Look at this. The lame walk. The blind see, the gospel is preached to the poor. He doesn't need to wait for anybody else. He saw me, he saw the dove descending, he prophesied, he declared, this is the one whom I spoke of. He must increase, I must decrease, there's nobody else coming. You just encourage John right now. Now these guys turn on their heels, they turn back and they go back to John there in prison. And when they walk away, Jesus, it's almost as if he wants to tell the crowd something about John because they could have had an idea about John. Now, John was a man just like all of us, right? He was born into the flesh just like all of us. He was just a man. Yes, he was a prophet. Yes, he was a great man. Yes, he was a baptizer, but he still had the sin nature on the inside of him. Okay, he's not Jesus. Now, Jesus turns to the crowd and he says, what did you guys go to see when you went to see John? Did you go to see a reed shaking in the wind? You know, you go to see somebody that's crazy, they're unstable, you know. People are filling up stadiums these days with instability. People are on TV with instability. So he says, is that what you went out to see? Did you go to see a reality TV show out there in the desert? And they said, no, we didn't, you know. He said, no, you didn't go see a reach. Did you go to see a prophet? Yeah, he's a prophet, but much greater than that. He says, look at this. You're there in Matthew chapter 8. Turn back to Matthew chapter 11. Let's take a look at what Jesus says about John the Baptist. Okay? He says, this is the one who will prepare the way of the Lord. He starts to quote the scripture in verse number 11 of chapter number 11, Matthew 11, 11. Take a look at what Jesus says. He says, assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women. Now that's everybody, right? Can't get born without a mama. So among those born of women, so everybody, there has not risen one greater than, everybody say greater than. Amen. Greater than John the Baptist. That is quite high praise coming from the mouth of Jesus, isn't it? Think about that for a second. This is God in the flesh saying there's nobody greater on the face of the earth ever than John the Baptist. Up to that point. Now, John didn't do any miracles. You can read that in your Bible. They said, John gave us no sign. John didn't do any miracles. And yet we believe the testimony of John to be true. So here comes John the Baptist. What made him greater than Elijah the prophet? What made him greater than Noah? What made him greater than Abraham? What made him greater than all these guys that we would see? What made him greater than David with all of his exploits and his kingdom? What made him greater than Solomon with his wisdom? What made him greater than all these guys? Can I share with you what it is? It's the fact that he had the ministry of preparing the way of the Lord. He was the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Who else had that job? No one else was gonna prepare the way of the Lord. No one else would be the one to baptize Jesus and the Spirit descend on him like a dove and that would inaugurate his earthly ministry. Who else had that privilege than John the Baptist? This was a great man. He was a preacher of righteousness. He was a preacher of the kingdom of God coming. He was a preacher of repentance. He was warning people about the judgment and the wrath that was to come. This was a great man. And Jesus said, no one else greater than him of those born among the sons of men. But the thought transitions right here. But he who is least, everybody say least, in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. He who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. In other words, he's saying what we value in this world, what we look at in the natural as greatness, if you've just got the entry level, if you become like a little child, you humble yourself, you get that attitude of submission to the Lord, and now you are in the kingdom of heaven, you can have true greatness in life. Not diminishing John the Baptist, elevating the kingdom of God. You understand? You say, well, how does that work, Pastor? Here's how. Because even though John had the ministry of preparing the way of the Lord, John was still living under old covenant law. And he died before Jesus ever went to the cross. So John did what John did under the old covenant, under the rules and regulations, under the law. And therefore, John, as great as he was, never had what we have in our lives as Christians. Think about that for a second. We'll discuss what that means. Because if we enter the kingdom of God, we humble ourselves like a little child, we become as little children, we enter the kingdom of God, now we have a position that is greater than the greatest man that ever lived before the cross, John the Baptist. Greater than David. Greater than Solomon. Come on, somebody, think about this. Greater than Elijah, the prophet, calling down fire out of heaven on the sacrifice. Greater. And yet we still see ourselves, well, I'm just me. I'm just living here in the IE. I've been, you know, my parents were born here. I'm born here. They never did anything. I guess I'll never do anything. We have these mentalities, looking for everybody else to do something, but never looking at, God, what do you want to do in me? God, what's going on in my life? God, what's happening here? See, if God can raise up a church in a bankrupt city, if God can gather a people from every tribe and every nation, every tongue, into one place to himself, if God can raise these people up to do great exploits and to be world famous, you didn't know this, but you're world famous. There are people that watch you from Australia. There are people who are checking you out in India. I know people who watch from China. Do you know that? People all over the world want to find out what you're doing here at The Rock. When we go out to the streets and when we go and we love people to life, when we hand out backpacks, there are churches who will travel the world to come to this place to go stand in our food lines and see what we're doing to help people out. And then they take that back and they go and they implement that at their church. There are people who have come and they have walked the aisle so that they can follow RSPTs here. And they want to learn what they're doing and how they're doing it. And what is this discipleship process you have here at The Rock? Now, I'm not boasting in myself. I'm boasting in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if God can do that with a church in a bankrupt city, what can God do in your life? God wants to do greater things. I'll tell you that right now. God wants to do greater things. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, God wants to do greater things in you, brother. God wants to do greater things in you, sister. Look at your other neighbor and say, greatness is on the inside of you. I can see it. How are we going to live a greater life in Christ? A couple of things I want to share with you tonight. How to do this. What is it that when we look at the greater life, what are the things that we can expect? What are the things that we can see in the kingdom that are greater? First one is this, greater wisdom. Greater wisdom. We mentioned Solomon. Solomon was the greatest man of his day. He had so much wisdom. This guy had so much wealth. He had so much wisdom that he brought in so much wealth into the kingdom that it says that silver was so common, they treated it like just gravel. It was just stones to them. That was just, oh, that's just silver. Just leave it there on the floor. I don't need it. I got enough of that. I got plenty of gold. Don't need that. I mean, this guy had wealth beyond what we could even imagine. He had people that would bring to him tribute. He had stuff going, I mean, horses. He had houses. He had everything going on. He had people coming, traveling from afar. And Jesus started to talk about this. Turn with me maybe a page or two over. Matthew chapter 12, verse number 42. Matthew chapter 12, verse number 42, Jesus is talking about the judgment. But look at what he says, verse number 42. He says, the queen of the south will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And indeed, a greater than Solomon is here. You know what Jesus just said? He said, Solomon was wise. Solomon was wonderful in his wisdom, and yet somebody greater than Solomon's here. Jesus Christ has way more wisdom than Solomon does. Why? Because he's God in the flesh. So he says, someone greater than Solomon is now here. Now, think about it for a second. If Jesus has greater wisdom than Solomon, you following me? You tracking? And Jesus lives on the inside of me. And when I pray and when I listen, I can hear Jesus' voice, then I have more wisdom than Solomon did. Okay, see, some of you guys got a hold of that right now. You have more wisdom than Solomon did available to you. Why? Because the Spirit of Christ lives on the inside of you. If you ever don't know what to do, all you got to do is stop and say, Jesus, what do I do? And then listen for his voice. He will give you the wisdom that you need. I know men, great men, who are Christian men, who just applied the principle of praying and listening, and in their business became wealthier than many other people that I know of, that worked and toiled and labored and went to convention, did all this kind of, all they did was they just listened. Okay, God, you want me to do that? You want me to invest here? All right. Made tons of money. People who have not known what to do in their marriage, wrecked their marriage, put everything, tore it all to pieces and didn't know how to put it back together again. Looking at Humpty Dumpty going, I don't know what to do with him, Lord. And yet prayed and listened, and God gave them the wisdom. Now their marriages are strong and healthy. New people didn't know what to do with their children. Came into church and said, Pastor, I don't know what to do with my kids. I've tried everything. I've done it all. Let's pray. Let's ask the Holy Spirit. As you go throughout your day, just ask the Lord what he wants you to do. And as they prayed, oh my goodness. I love it. If you go over here to Loma Linda University Medical Center and walk through their halls, you'll see pictures of doctors with their books out and all this medical science stuff. And there's Jesus over their shoulder pointing at something. That's such a picture for us. That is such a picture for us. We need Jesus over our shoulder saying, hey, look right here. Hey, no, no, no. Do this over here. Do that. There's a reason why they are a world-renowned medical center, people coming in from all over the planet to find out what they're doing, because we have greater wisdom. Now, greater wisdom requires greater sensitivity to the Spirit. Turn me to John chapter 14. Let's take a look at this. See, even though you have the wisdom available to you, doesn't mean you're going to use it. Hello? See, we got to put this stuff into practice in our life. And if you're going to get a hold of the wisdom, you need to pray, you need to listen. Let's take a look at it, John chapter 14. Jesus is talking about the helper who's going to come, the Holy Spirit. John chapter 14, verse number 26. And he says this, but the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, that in my name means in my authority, in my power, in my likeness. The word for the Holy Spirit is parakletos. He's the one who comes alongside and is the exact similitude of that which was before. So the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ coming to us that God sends in his name and his authority. Look at what it says. He will teach you how many things? Does that apply to science? That doesn't apply to science? Oh, no, it does apply to science, right? Because science is part of that all, right? He will teach you all things. Does that apply to your business? Yes, it does. Does that apply to parenting? Oh, but that doesn't apply to parenting in the 21st century, does it? That doesn't apply to California, right? Well, that applies to all things. Does that apply to your marriage? Absolutely. But Dad, you don't know. You don't know who I'm married to, Pastor. I mean, he's just a jerk. You know? Listen, he's a part of that all. God knows how to get a hold of his sons. Pastor, you don't know the woman. It is all a woman, right? You sound like Adam. Adam and Eve. That applies to him. Look at what it says. He will teach you all things. And look at this. And bring to your remembrance all things I said to you. Isn't that amazing? That means if God said something to you, now the Holy Spirit has access to bring it to your remembrance. But it requires you getting intimate with the Holy Spirit. It requires you getting into the Word of God. It requires you getting into prayer. It requires you getting into the face of God. See, the more you put in, the more God can get out. The more you hear, the more you listen, the more you sit in church, the more you pray, the more you study, the more you read, the more you put in, now the Holy Spirit has access. It's like putting books in a library. Think about it like this. The more books you put in that library, the more the Holy Spirit can go, oh, you need that? Here you go. Right here. Oh, you're dealing with business? Proverbs. I got it for you right here. Oh, you're dealing with marriage? Ephesians chapter 5. Here you go, right here. See, you can have the greatest wisdom. You don't need the wisdom of Solomon. You don't need someone else. You don't need a pastor to tell you what to do. You have the Holy Spirit. You have the anointing that teaches you all things. And then as you pray, as you press, as you listen, the Holy Spirit will give you the wisdom and you will be successful in every area of your life. Greater wisdom. How about this one? Greater ministry. It's a greater ministry. God has a ministry for you. God looks at you and he sees a full-time minister, not just the paid staff of the church here at The Rock. No, he looks at you and he says, I've got something for you to do. You know what ministry is? Literally, you could define it like this, a service to the people. That's what ministry is. Jesus came and he ministered. He served people. But did you know under the old covenant, there was a ministry. It was a ministry of death and condemnation. But now we have a greater ministry. We have greater ability given to us. Let's take a look at it. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, turn there with me. It's talking about the old covenant versus the new covenant. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3. Under the old covenant, there was a ministry that took place. Second Corinthians chapter number 3. And take a look. Verse number 7 through verse number 9. Look at what it says, 2 Corinthians chapter number 3, verse number 7. Look at what it says. But if the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away. Now stop right there. Some of you guys don't know what's going on here. What are you talking about right there? Basically, Moses, when he would go and he would speak to the Lord, because he was talking to God face to face, the Bible says, like a friend speaks to a friend. Because of that, Moses' face would light up. It literally would glow. His countenance would glow. And so Moses would walk out of the tent, and as he's walking out of the tent, he's glowing physically, right? In broad daylight glowing. So think about how bright his face must have been to glow in the daylight. And so naturally, as people do, when they see something kind of freaky, they stared. So Moses, as people do, when people are staring at you, gets uncomfortable. And he realizes something's wrong. And probably, this is just what I think. This isn't in the word, but this is probably what I think might have happened. He probably went, hey, Aaron. Hey, bro. What's going on? Everyone's looking. Every time I go on and talk to the Lord, everyone's staring at me. He says, Moses, bro, your face is glowing. Freaking everyone out. He says, what? It's glowing. Go look in that pool of water over there. Goes and looks and oh my goodness, right? So what Moses would do is he would put a veil over his face so that the people wouldn't stare at him anymore, so that he wouldn't be uncomfortable. And it's likening that to the old covenant. The old covenant in the stones, right? They respected and they revered the law. It was glorious. It was shining. It was something. And yet that glory, the Bible says, was fading away. It could not last. Look at verse number 8. It says, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? Everybody say more glorious. See, there was a brightness, there was a respect and awe for what God did in the old covenant. We should never diminish what God did because without the law, we would have never been brought to Christ. And therefore, we respect the law, we understand it. We don't have to live by it because now it's been fulfilled in Christ, so we are no longer held to the letter of the law. Now it's according to the Spirit. So the ministry of the Spirit is now more glorious. In other words, our lives shine brighter under the new covenant than they did under the old covenant. Verse number 9, for if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. Wow. That means God has called us to a greater ministry. But a greater ministry requires something of our life. Just like greater wisdom requires us to press into the Lord, greater ministry requires something of our lives, requires greater transformation into his likeness. See, our lives, our ministry should flow from our being with God. Just like Moses would go into the presence of God and the glory would shine through him, in the same way, we need to have our lives be transformed into his likeness. See, many times people say, Pastor, I want to do what you do. Well, I can't give that to you. They say, what's the path to being a pastor? I'm sorry, I don't know. Well, what did you do? I just followed Jesus and this is where I ended up. Never knew. See, if I could tell you my story for a second, I didn't want to do this. I wanted to do this. I wanted to play rock and roll. I wanted to sing. I wanted to be the superstar. I wanted to be on TV. I wanted to do all that kind of stuff, play guitar, and wanted to, you know, show off my musical ability. And then maybe on down the road, you know, I'll use that as a platform for what I, you know. But see, for me, it was all about being the superstar. God says, it's not about you being the superstar. Jesus is the superstar. You're a servant. You just follow me. And so I laid that down on the altar as a living sacrifice. I said, okay, God, I'm going to lay this down. I'm going to give this over to you, and God, I'll just follow you. And as I followed Jesus, if I could put it to you like this, I just stuck my nose right in the back of his shoulder blades, right in the middle. Just put my nose right there and just follow Jesus. And whenever he would move, I would move. Wherever he went, I went. And every now and then I'd look up and go, oh, I didn't realize I'd be going, well, okay. You know, and then follow him over here. And, well, look at this. Oh, I'm doing young adults ministry. That's cool, you know. And then all of a sudden over here, and wow, look at this, executive pastor. Hey, that's pretty neat. See, all I did was just follow the Lord. All I did was follow Jesus. I didn't have this plan. I didn't see seven easy steps to being a pastor or anything like that. It was just follow Jesus. And can I tell you something? I don't know what path God has you on, but the Lord does. And if you trust him and you press into him and you follow him, he will lead you into greatness. That greatness might be over there in the children's ministry, teaching the young kids who will raise up and become the next Billy Grahams and the next great evangelist and the next great healing ministers and the next great missionaries. That path might lead you onto the streets where you'll be reaching people who would have died otherwise. People, you might have a rescue mission at the gates of hell, snatching people out of the fire. And there might be multitudes in heaven because of what you did out there on the streets. I can't tell you what your ministry is, but if you follow Jesus, if you just press into him, you will be conformed in his likeness and you will serve as you see him serving. Take a look. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, drop down the last verse in the chapter, verse number 18. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image. You know what that image is? That's the image of Christ. If we are face to face with Jesus, if we're following him, then we're going to start looking like him from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Wow. Just brings us to the last one for tonight. Not only greater wisdom and greater ministry, but how about this one? Greater works. Greater works. We have labored over this verse about the greater works. Why don't we see the greater works? Why don't we see the miracles? Why don't we see the signs and wonders like we did in Jesus' day? I want to bring some thoughts to you today. Let's read the verse, John chapter 14. Turn back to the Gospel of John. We'll be in the Gospel of John for most of the rest of the night tonight. John chapter number 14, take a look at it. Verse number 12. Jesus is speaking and he says these words. He says, most assuredly, I say to you. This is a guarantee from Jesus. You realize that? He didn't have to say most assuredly. He could have just said, I say to you. He could have just made the statement, but he qualifies it. He puts an extra emphasis on it. Most assuredly, I say to you. He who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works. Everybody say greater works. Greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father. Now there's a couple of thoughts on this because we've looked at this verse and we've said, well, wait a second. I haven't healed as many people as Jesus healed. I haven't raised as many people from the dead as Jesus raised from the dead. I have not, given words of knowledge like Jesus gave. So how could it be that I can do greater works than Jesus when I haven't even healed a single person? I haven't preached a message on the mountain. How can it be that I'm doing greater works than Jesus is doing? Now, there's a couple of thoughts here because Jesus did the work of redemption. carried it out on the cross, and all the works that he did were pre the cross. Now we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Now we are bringing people into relationship with God, and that is a greater ministry, if you will, than healing physical bodies, natural things. Now, that's okay, and I understand that, I get that, but I think that God's speaking about something else. I think that God is taking us into an area in our life. See, greater works require something on our life. If we're going to see the greater works, if we're going to see greater things, if we're going to see greater in not only the quality, yes, because we are ministering the gospel, which Jesus came preaching, the kingdom of God is near, right? Now we're preaching the kingdom of God has come, and you can come into that kingdom, right? So not only that, not only the number of believers that are out there as well. You think about it, there was one Jesus on the planet, but there are many believers today, millions if not billions on the planet today, right? So we could say greater in numbers. But I believe that God is speaking to our lives, and I believe that God is saying that it requires greater faith and greater prayers on our part. That as we encourage ourselves and as we build ourselves up in our most holy faith, as we pray and we press into the Lord, and as we believe God for great things, we are going to see the miracles, the signs, and the wonders, and the gifts of the Holy Ghost like never before. How do I know that? Here's how. Look at the verse. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me. Could it be that we're an unbelieving church? Could it be that we don't really believe in the miraculous like we say that we do? Could it be that we've had disappointments and therefore our expectation is at an all-time low? And therefore, rather than press in, rather than pray, rather than get in faith and believe God, we have backed off and said, well, I guess it's not real. I guess it's not really true. Come on, somebody. Can we talk? Can we be honest in church? Because when I look around and I see people, I wish I could say that I see people expecting the miraculous. Wish I could say when I talk to Christians, I just have this atmosphere of faith in every person that I come across. Now, there are those that, my goodness, that person just encouraged me. Wow, just getting around them just brings me up to a new level. But for the most part, and this is a generalization, I understand that. All generalizations are false, including this one, okay? That was a joke. Lighten up the mood a little bit. And yet, for the most part, I don't see Christians, quote unquote, believing God for great and mighty things. Not looking for the greater works. We're looking for someone else. Looking for the next great person, the next great superstar. We're looking for the next president. We're looking for somebody else to take care of our issues. Instead of getting into the face of God, being transformed into his image, praying and believing God, getting in faith, and allowing the Spirit of God to work greater works in us. Are you listening? Let's look at it. John chapter 14, verse number 10. He's talking to the disciples. Philip says, Jesus, show us the Father. That'll be enough for us. Jesus says, haven't I been amongst you this long? You don't even know me? Verse number 10, look at what he says. Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority. That's quite a statement if you think about it. Jesus said, I'm not speaking this on my own authority. He could have because he's God in the flesh. But even Jesus humbled himself to the point where he would come in the likeness of sinful flesh, being made sin on the cross, and the works that he did not do it in his own power. He did it in the power of the Holy Spirit, and he did not speak in his own authority. He spoke on the authority of the Father. Remember where we started? You got to be converted and become like a little child. We have to humble ourselves in order for this to take place. This is not because we're so cool. You become a Christian, you're so cool that you can do greater things. You got greater wisdom because of you. This is not because of you. It's because of the Spirit of God in you. See, on my own, I don't know nothing. There is no wisdom. There's only stupidity. That shows every time I get in the flesh. Because it ends up bad. It doesn't end up great. Oh, look what I did. I was in the flesh and everything worked out right. No, it all goes to the toilet when I get in the flesh. Anybody give me a witness? Somebody's honest in this place. Hallelujah. I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me. Hello? The Father who dwells in me does the works. Hold on, Jesus, I thought you were the one healing people. Hold on, Jesus, I thought you were the one teaching and preaching. Wait a second, Jesus, didn't you raise the dead? He says, it's not me, it's the Father in me doing the work. If that's the attitude of Jesus, then as imitators of Christ, following his example, if we're gonna do the greater works, we have to have the same attitude. This is not because I'm so cool. This is not because I'm so nice. Not because I'm so smart. Not because I'm so educated. Not because I go to the Rock or because I'm this or that. This is not because of any of that. This is because of Jesus and Jesus only. This is only the Spirit of God working. Only God can do the miraculous. Only God can save. Only God can restore. Only God can heal. Only God can redeem. Only God can take care of our lives. Only God can take care of San Bernardino. Only God can save the United States. Only God can save this world. Drop down to verse 13. And whatever, everybody say whatever. Amen. Whatever you ask in my name, that I will do. Remember, Jesus said, it's not me, it's the Father that's in me. I'll go to the Father, I'll send you the helper. Whatever you ask in my name, you're not gonna do it. You get to partner up with it, yes. You get to be a part of it. There's always the God part and the man part. So you do your part, God will do his part. Look at, he says, I will do that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Jesus is working in his church today. Each and every individual Christian, every person that names the name of Jesus that has been born of the Spirit of God. Spirit of God lives on the inside of them now. And now we have access to the greater power within. 1 John, last verse for today. As you go from this place, if you remember nothing else, remember this. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 4. You are of God, little children. You notice that? We started with, unless you become like little children. And now we're ending. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them. You know who the them is? The devil, the world system, the flesh, the financial systems, the systems of this world, the elementary principles, those things that would try and drag you into bondage, you have overcome them. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Hallelujah. You go to sleep tonight, think about who's living on the inside. Don't get enamored with yourself. In yourself, you were headed for hell. So was I. In a greasy, slippery handbasket, right? We were grease lightning. And yet God snatched us out of the fire. God saved us. God raised us. God cleaned us up. God set our feet upon the rock. Now the Spirit of Christ lives on the inside of us. We have the greatest wisdom that we could ever have. His name is Jesus. We have the greatest ministry we could ever have. If we press into him, follow him, put our nose in his shoulder blades, and go after him. And we have the greatest works, the greater works are available to us. I'd like to close with a story that I heard just this week. We brought new interns on this week here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, working in our youth departments, our children department, the young adults, in our sound department back there. I don't know if Andrew's back there. Wave at me if you are. No, he's not back there. Okay, another time we'll embarrass him. But anyways, great group of young people serving and giving a year of their life here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. So neat to see their hearts for the Lord. And they brought them up, and they do a day where they do like competition. I don't think they're competition. They're team building exercises, if you will, right? And get them. They have relays and different things like that. Like one of the things they had to do was hold a canoe over their head as long as they could, right? And so they'd have to switch out and use different arms, and different people would switch in and this and that. And so they had to see how long they could go. And so they had all these different things. And anytime somebody would kind of hit a wall, they would not be able to complete the task that was in front of them. They had a cross set up off to the side. And so they would say, oh, I just can't do this. And they'd put them to the cross. So they'd have to go to the cross. They'd have to kneel down. They'd have to pray, okay, Lord, help me with this. I can't do it. Then they'd go back and they'd finish the task. And they shared with me that there was one exercise that everybody was involved in. They had to do it together. And they tried 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 four or five times, just could not get it. Everybody's frustrated, pulling their hair out, don't know what to do, just crying. And our intern director, Bess, she's just, go to the cross. And so they go, and as a group, they all gather and they kneel together at the cross. Lord, help us. We can't do it. We don't know what's wrong. As they're praying, each and every one of them all got the same thing from God. Slow down and do it together, and it'll work. They got up, they went back, they slowed down, they worked together, and they were able to complete the task. Now, why do I share that? In your life, you're going to hit a wall. You're going to hit obstacles. There's going to be things that come against you. Pressures, trials, problems. The opportunities for disappointments. You might pray for somebody and they don't get healed right away. It's okay. Go kneel at the cross. You might have some problems on the job. Think that you're doing the right thing. Think that you heard from the Lord and yet problems are coming up. Go to the cross. You might have some times where you're working with your family and I don't know, I've been trying to, I thought I was doing this the right way. It's time to go kneel. Spend some time with Jesus. Allow God to infuse the power of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. Give you that word, that direction. You press your nose into his back and you follow him. As you do, the greater works will take place in your, in my life. We will see your life, this community, this valley, this nation changed to the glory of God the Father. Come on, somebody. Let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Woo! I want to take just a couple more minutes of your time and talk to you about your eternal life. And make sure before you leave this place, your heart is right with God, and that if you died, you would go to heaven and you wouldn't go to hell. Sometimes people say, oh, Pastor, harsh. Why would you use that term? That's an offensive term. Hell, ew. That's like a fairy tale parents made up to scare their children into being good. No. The Bible talks about hell, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of hell. It's a very real place. Tonight, I want to make sure you don't end up there. I know you don't want to go there, but listen, most of all, God doesn't want you to go there. He loves you so much. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, so you didn't have to go to hell. And yet, God loves us enough that he doesn't want us to be a bunch of robots. He could have created millions of robots that would just love him, we love you, Lord, you know, serve him. But he wanted us to love him out of our free will. That's a true love. That's a real love. And therefore, God gives us the choice. We can either choose him or we can reject him. Choose hell with our lives. It's our choice. You say, well, Pastor, don't all roads lead to heaven? I mean, God opened up the way with Jesus and the cross. And he loves us so much. Doesn't that mean that God just wants us to be there and he'll make it happen? God going to make me go to heaven? Listen, God's not going to make you do anything. Like we just discussed, he gives us free will choice while we're here on the earth. And not all roads lead to heaven. That's like saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You're never going to make it. The same way, you can't just do whatever you want and think that you're going to get to heaven. Sometimes people say, well, isn't it by being good? I think that God lets good people into heaven, right? I've heard that somewhere, and there's got to be in the Bible, you know, and God wants us to be good. And if I just clean up my act, you know, I used to be bad, now I'm good. Clean up my act and haven't knocked over a 7-Eleven in a while. I've been really nice to my neighbors and given money to charities and things like that. You know, I've been good. Maybe it's good enough for God. You know, my good outweighs my bad. I've been working on my resume. God's going to see that and appreciate that and let me in, won't he? You know that nowhere in the Bible says you can be good enough to get to God. Can't do enough, serve enough, give enough. See, people get off on this thing, maybe if I sit in church enough, maybe if I serve in church enough, volunteer. You're talking about volunteering tonight. That's a good thing. I'll do that and think that God's going to let you in heaven. It doesn't work like that. Doesn't matter if you were raised in church, parents told you you're a Christian, growing up, born in America. That does not qualify you for heaven. You say, but Pastor, hold on a second. I know God. Yeah? Even the demons know God. They know who he is. I can quote scriptures, Pastor. Yeah, the devil can quote scriptures. That didn't qualify him for heaven. Everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about your mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. Rather, this is about your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Now, we've kind of talked about that a little bit, about the kingdom of heaven. Those that are least in the kingdom of heaven, unless you humble yourself and be converted like a little child, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus said you must be born again, becoming like that little child once again. Now, there was a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. This guy had it going on. He was a religious leader. He could quote the scripture. He could sing the scripture. How many of us could do that? He could debate the scripture. He did good works in his community. He gave his money there at the temple. And yet, when Jesus comes to him, he doesn't pat him on the back and say, Nick, man, hey, keep doing what you're doing. I'll see you in heaven. No, rather, what does he say? He says, you must be born again. Now, Nicodemus had a question. He said, I don't understand this. I can't get back in my mother's womb and pop back out. What are we talking about here? Jesus said, Nicodemus, you don't get it. What's born of the flesh is flesh, but what's born of the spirit is spirit. You must be born again. It means that you have to humble yourself and get rid of that old life and allow the Spirit of God to come on the inside, and you'd be recreated from the inside out. You can't clean up your act enough. You can't sit in church enough. You can't volunteer enough. You can't give enough money. It has to be a work of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. You've got to give God exactly what he wants, which is all of your heart and all of your life. That's what being born again really is. It means that you've given God all of your heart, all of your life. If you do that, you are now born again. God comes on the inside and does that work of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. You're recreated. It's just that simple. Now, in a moment, I want to give you an opportunity to do just that, to be born again. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and go bang. Pop my hands together just like that. Bang. When you hear that sound, that's your opportunity to lift your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that tonight. Think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Come on. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. No one's that dumb. And yet the devil thinks that you are. That's why he's trying to talk you out of it right now. You say, well, Pastor, it feels like you're pushing me. Yeah, I'm pushing you because the devil's pushing you into hell. I'm trying to push you towards God right now, towards heaven, towards eternal life. Will you give God all of your heart? And will you give God all of your life? Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. This is a safe and friendly church service. No one's criticizing, judging, or condemning. We all love you. We want you to do this. We've all done this, okay? Now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand? If you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life, being born again. I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you say, lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted before God. Not going to make it. Because Jesus made this statement in the book of Revelation. He said, when I come, I want to find you hot or cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, what does that mean? Simply this, that people that are lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. They're going to be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, if that's you in any of those four categories that I mentioned, get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer down at the Love Rock Cafe, if you can hear the sound of my voice out there on the benches, you stopped and you're listening in the breezeways. Ready to get your hand up, and then you can come into the church service or tell an usher right afterwards. On the live stream, across the nation and around the world, wherever you're at, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God's watching. Then you can click the button, blue button, if you minimize the video browser that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and click the button that says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. There's seven, eight. God bless you. Eight wise people already. Nine over there. Gotcha. 10 up there. Thank you. 10 wise people on this side. Where are you at? 10, 11. Thank you. Back in the family room. Gotcha. Gotcha up there. Thank you. 11 wise people already. Anybody else real quick? 11, 12. Gotcha over there. Thank you. Thank you right there. Who else? There's a dozen wise people. If that's you. Thank you. 13. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? 13. Where are you at? Just give me a little wave if I don't. Thank you. 14. God bless you, man. Go for it. All right. Thank you. I got you guys already. You can put your hands down. Thank you. There's about 14 wise people already. Don't you just know there's number 15? You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Where are you at, number 15? Just pop it up high when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Anybody else real quick? Thank you. God bless you. Thank you for the wave, too. God is so good. Let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Hallelujah. Now, Real quick, because the preacher went long because you guys were just saying too good of amens tonight, all right? Once you, if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, it's not too late. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle and meet me up front right now. Come on down. Come on down. From the family rooms, you can bring your children. Come on down. Coming, come on, let's give them a hand. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Man, there's room for you. Come on down right now. If you raise your hand, just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Come on down. Bring your children, bring your family, bring your friends. Come on, come on, come on.
I believe in you, Lord. Yeah, yeah.
They're still coming. Come on, let's give them a hand. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. All right. Hey, everybody up front. Look up here. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, okay? Came to give God all your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Right over here to my right. Look right over here. See this guy waving at you in the black shirt and jacket? A really cool guy. His name's Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about what to do next in your walk with God. Now that you're a Christian, what do you do next? Okay? Then he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Let me summarize it for you like this. It's a friend in church who'll help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how it works, then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family are going to wait for you. Now listen, before I let you go, let me just encourage you in something. Get back to church as often as you can. In fact, give us 1 year of your life sitting under the teaching here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. After that year and for the rest of your life, you will look around and say, oh my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right. Take their word for it, okay? So if you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great...
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me, and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.